What's up, guys? It's DDP, and today I'm going to give you my 10 takeaways from yesterday's 24-13 loss for the Cowboys at Seattle. But before I get there, consider subscribing to the channel. I bring out all new Cowboys content, Mavericks content, pop culture content, you name it, I got it. Go ahead and subscribe. Mic check, 212, bitch. Now at number 10, we're not going to mince words here. We are going right after the starting quarterback, Dak Prescott. For the game, Prescott completed just 19 of 34 passes for 168 yards with one touchdown and two interceptions. Through three games now, Prescott is averaging just over 162 yards passing, and he has two touchdown passes on the season. That is not going to get it done, ever. Making matters worse, Prescott had less than 50 yards passing at halftime with the Cowboys down 17-3 on the road. You're not going to win games if your quarterback can't get the ball to his receivers. And while some people want to say it's not all on Dak, it's about the receivers getting open, you have to also look at the tape and consider all the times that receivers are standing there wide open and Prescott either misses the read or simply chooses not to go to that guy. While Prescott did get credit for his pass to Tavon Austin for a touchdown late in the game, it was on a shuttle pass, which is damn near impossible to mess up from a quarterback's perspective. At number 9, we're sticking with Dak Prescott, but we're pivoting slightly. This is more about the play calling itself. We didn't see any RPO action until 7 minutes and change left in this game. The same RPO action that opened up the offense a little bit against the New York Giants, but was absent the week before against Carolina, was mostly once again absent yesterday, with Dallas getting just 2 carries out of Dak Prescott for 21 yards. When you already have a quarterback who's not a pocket passer and you refuse to get him out of the pocket and moving, you're setting yourself up for failure. This is on Scott Linehan and to a lesser extent Jason Garrett. The play calling was again wretched. At number 8, we have the engine of the Cowboys offense, Ezekiel Elliott. Now, on the ground, Elliott had himself a day, but the problem is there were several mental lapses, which I'll get into here momentarily, that really affected his overall performance. For the game, Elliott had 16 carries, good for 127 yards, for an average of 7.9 yards a carry. Now, that's serious production, but the problem comes in the form of the mental mistakes that he made. On his biggest carry of the day, a roughly 30-yard carry inside the Seattle 10, Elliott fumbled the ball, showing poor ball security, which effectively cost the Cowboys a serious scoring opportunity. And while I won't say it's what cost them the game, it certainly took a bad situation and made it much worse for the Dallas offense. Additionally, you had an apparent 20-plus yard touchdown catch for Zeke overturned by the fact that he stepped on the sideline before catching the ball and then breaking a couple tackles and outracing everyone to the end zone. This missed opportunity forced the Cowboys to settle for a Brett Maher field goal and take what should have been 7 and only come out with 3. We then had 2 more instances of Zeke making mental errors in the passing game, one of which was on a drop in the open field, which would have been a first down catch and then some, had Zeke simply kept his eyes on the ball until it was all the way into his hands. The other came late in the game in garbage time when Dallas was simply trying to move the field. Again, Zeke lost his awareness of where the sideline was and stepped on the sideline before catching the ball. So Zeke, great game running the ball, bad game in terms of mental errors. At number 7, we take a look at the Seattle offense, which through the 2 previous weeks was leading the NFL in giving up 12 sacks. 12 sacks through 2 weeks. This was believed to be an offensive line that could not protect Russell Wilson to save their life. And in spite of all of that, Dallas managed a meager 2 sacks for the game. Keep in mind, Dallas was rated the 2nd best team through 2 weeks at getting to the quarterback at 9, just 1 behind the Chicago Bears. Not much else to be said here. This is simply a huge disappointment for the Cowboys defense, specifically that defensive line. Number 6. Appropriately, this was the, 6th time in 11 contests that the Cowboys failed to produce at least 14 points. Keep that in mind, because that That tells you a lot about the trends. I can throw out all kinds of stats about how long it's been since Dak has thrown for 200 yards. I can tell you how long it's been since he's thrown for 215 yards and all of that. But in the case of last week, you had a situation where, yes, they scored more than 14 points, but Dak's low numbers didn't affect the outcome of the game. This week, it absolutely did. The Cowboys' offense simply has to find a way to be better, and these problems are now stretching 9, 10, 11, however long you want to look back, basically all the way back to Atlanta last year, and they're not going to be corrected by this coaching staff. At this point, I'm just convinced of that. Number 5. The last time the Cowboys had a 100-yard receiver who added a touchdown was November 13th, 2016. Do you know who that was? I'm sure your guess was probably right on the money. It was Dez Bryant. Now, this shows how inept the offense has been because, yes, Dez had his problems here last year. Yes, a lot of that was on the offense. Yes, a lot of that was on Dak. Some of it was on Dez as well. But you still are looking at something where the offense isn't producing from the receiving position. And now you're looking at something that's been done 111 times around the league since the Cowboys last did it. It's not that hard of an ask. 100 yards plus one touchdown. This offense can't seem to get that done. Number 4. Earl Thomas. Now, ET had himself two interceptions in the game yesterday, which oddly I predicted on the Thursday night live stream preview, but to be honest, I was even kind of surprised with the way they came down. Yes, they show off that Earl is a phenomenal athlete and has fantastic ball skills, but at the same time, as he's taking his bow to the Cowboys offense, I'm finding myself thinking, that's cool and all, and that is certainly ironic that you're the one who's undoing us in this game, but I think our problems go beyond just the safety position at this point. Here's the thing, guys. As much as I would like to have Earl Thomas on this team, he's clearly not going to work this out with Seattle. They're not going to pay him what he wants. He will be a free agent this summer. Meanwhile, Dallas has to figure out its quarterback, its receivers, its tight ends, and find a couple more pieces along the defense, potentially, to really make itself a true contender. So why would you give up assets right now for Earl Thomas if you have a very good chance of signing him this summer anyway, and it's not like you're going to win a championship this year or even really compete for the playoffs with the way this offense is looking right now? Now, I'm by no means throwing in the towel. I'm simply stating the problems with this offense are clearly a ball and chain around this team's ankle, and the odds of the defense being great enough to drag them to the playoffs with them just doesn't feel all that great right now. So Earl Thomas, I like you, I want you on the team, but in the meantime, we got to keep those draft picks because we have some serious needs that we have to address. Number 3, and this is where I eat crow.
Do it!
I don't have a prop or anything, otherwise I would pretend to take a big bite out of a stuffed crow or something like that. But LVE, man, I was one of those people who was very upset when the Cowboys drafted him, not because of the question I had about his talent, it was simply his health. And that is still something that we're going to have to see. But playing in relief of Sean Lee yesterday, who himself had 11 tackles, 6 solo by the way, LVE accumulated 11 tackles of his own, 10 of which were solo tackles. That is serious production out of the linebacking spot. Now, in the last 2 games, in 61 snaps, LVE has 18 total tackles. That's crazy. That is showing that the rookie first rounder, while he's not starting yet, he might have a really bright future, and Dallas might have actually hit on a pretty good draft pick. I would still argue you probably could have gotten him in round 2, but, you know, it is what it is. He can help the team, and that's a good value pick. Number 2. Speaking of Sean Lee, despite the fact that he recorded 11 tackles, and as I said, 6 of them were solo tackles, yesterday versus Seattle, Sean Lee also tweaked his other hamstring, and reports today are that he is going to miss, quote, several weeks of action. So now, we're going to have to see what we have with LVE. Like, okay, kid, you're starting. Can you keep this production up? And more importantly, can you stay healthy while doing it? If so, Dallas might have to take a serious look now at the 31-year-old Sean Lee and determine if they have him really in their plans for the future, because if they cut him this offseason, they'll save $7 million against the cap next year. Now, they're not hurting for cap, but it doesn't do you any good to invest a bunch of money in a player who can't stay on the field. They kept him in bubble wrap all preseason and did everything in their power to make sure that he was able to play and that he was at full capacity when the season arrived. Well, he was at full capacity, but he still broke like something made of glass, and then when he tried to play through that, he broke in a different way. So now they have to address what they're going to do, and it might be time to part with Sean Lee, which would just be one more significant face of the 2014 team, although he missed the 2014 season with a torn ACL, MCL. Zach Martin did it in the first day of padded practice, I recall. Actually, it was OTAs. All the same, Dallas might have to part from another integral part of the team's identity from just a few years ago. So that's a tough decision for Dallas to make, but let's see what LVE has. He was drafted to be not just insurance for a Sean Lee injury, but also the future replacement. That time might just come earlier than we expected. And number one, now you might be wondering why this one is here at number one, given all the other cool facts I've laid out. Really, this is just a general list of observations, just things I make notes of as I watch the game. Randy Gregory returned from a concussion and recorded no tackles, no stats in the box score whatsoever, and the only time you really noticed him was on a critical, and just bafflingly dumb and impulsive personal foul at the end of the first half. Seattle goes for it on third, I think 12, fails to convert, and then Randy Gregory, all up in his emotions, shoves at the face mask of a Seahawks player right in front of the official. 15-yard penalty, Seattle gets in range for a 47-yard kick, and guess what? Now they get three extra points. It's 17-3 at half, with Seattle getting the ball to start the second half. Why does Seattle get the ball? Because it is an approximately a 57,000% chance that Dallas will open every game with the ball. Why? Because if the Cowboys win the toss, Jason Garrett's going to take the ball, which is not the better strategy, and if the other team wins the toss, they're going to do the smart thing and defer like you always should. It makes no sense. It drives me insane. I know that's a different topic than what I was just talking about, but it's one of those things that kind of went hand in hand there. So Randy Gregory, man, you've got all the ability in the world, but I'm wondering a little bit if you got everything you need up top and that 6 inches of real estate between your ears, if you got everything you need to be able to become a great player. So we'll see. But those are my 10 observations from the Cowboys-Seattle game. Yesterday, Dallas moves to 1-2 on the season. They set up next Sunday at noon against the Detroit Lions. Stay tuned for a special announcement on that regarding myself, Law Nation, and potentially another one of the guys in our network as well. But stay tuned. Until next time, guys, just remember, every legend was once a prospect. Salute.